won't you meet me by the beam? Too early, maybe later you could show me things. You know what it is whenever I visit Windy City, she throwing me kisses. No, 30 degrees, way too cold, so hold me tight. Girl, I see you at the show tonight.
Osh Bansal, thank you so much for performing for us today.
Man, thanks for having
me. Right out there. It's a little bit windy, so we're going to do this inside today. So for everyone who's listening, can you just give a little background on yourself, when you started creating music, yeah, how you've gotten to the point you where you are today?
Yeah, absolutely. So my name is Osh Bansal. Thanks for having me. I've been a DJ and music producer for the last 16 years or so. I started kind of playing in bands in high school and stuff, mostly like punk music and ska music in high school.
What instrument were you playing?
I was playing guitar and singing and kind of writing a lot of the songs. And kind of as I evolved, like I started getting more in electronic music, and I was doing a lot of like live improv, like jam band electronica stuff for a couple of years. And after like a couple of bouts with some bands and stuff like that, I started DJing, and I really kind of fell headfirst into it. So around like 2006, 2007, I started just like fully focusing on electronic dance music and DJing. And at the time I was doing like more disco kind of oriented stuff. And that's kind of how I started my DJ career. And in the last few years, I've kind of evolved into finding like my own sound and carving out like my own space. So most recently, I just finished this album, which I'm so lucky to perform for you guys today. And that album is really just kind of a culmination of many, many years of trying to kind of produce and find my own sound. And finally, like having all this free time due to quarantine, but having all this free time to kind of sit there and really develop and hone in on what aspects were mine and what aspects I was like ripping off, for lack of a better term, from other people, and finding a way to focus on purely putting myself into the music so that when I heard it back and when people I showed it to heard it back were like, yeah, I hear you in it.
Very cool. So I think many musicians struggle with this or find this challenging to find their own sound. So I'm curious, you know, this is The Creative Process, the name of the podcast. So I'd love to dive into your creative process. So while you were making this new album to perform for us today, how would you say that you went about trying to find your own sound?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think it started with kind of finding some influences first and kind of tapping into what is going on in the electronic music scene worldwide right now. Obviously with coronavirus and all this shit, like, clubs are closed, right? You can't go out and party anymore. So for a long time, DJs and producers are making like straightforward club music, like music to go out and party and dance to with your friends. Well, that kind of shifted, right? There's nowhere to go out and dance right now. So I think a lot of what I was focusing on is inspirations that weren't so much like four on the floor kind of heavy, you know, techno or house beats, and trying to find something like that falls in the middle ground. And I'm very highly influenced by a lot of like the 90s rave scene and a lot of like 90s house music and that kind of stuff. Like, and some of maybe like the bigger big beat artists like the Prodigy and stuff like that. So a lot of the inspiration came from breakbeats. A lot of breakbeats are really heavily featured on the album. But a lot of it came from kind of breakbeats mixed with my heritage. So my heritage is Indian. My parents immigrated here from India in the late 60s, and they only listen to Hindi and Indian music. They don't listen to any American music. So growing up, still today, my parents literally only listen to Indian music. So growing up, my house, and my dad's also a musician, all it is Indian music constantly. And it's a lot of like vocal singing and, you know, a lot of like kind of communal stuff where like he'll have friends over and they'll just kind of like jam out. But a lot of the influences on the album are based on some of those notes I was hearing growing up. So a lot of that vocal singing I've like sampled and chopped up and like made it into like a more modern kind of take. So my approach going into the whole thing was, how do I take bits and pieces of influence from the past, my past, the music I listen to that's from the past, and how do I bring it into some modern connotation, but also applying myself throughout the music? So not forgetting about my roots and who I am, but also trying to kind of bring a modern take to the sound.
Very cool. So when you're actually starting a song, do you have a, what do you typically do when you start a song? Like, I know some people start with rhythm, some people start with melody, some people start with lyrics. Sure. So for you, how do you typically start a song?
Yeah, it depends. I would say 9 times out of 10, probably start with a beat. I'll probably start with something relatively simple on like a drum machine or something and then build on top of it. Or I'll find like a break sample that I like and I'm like, oh, let me chop this up. Let me rearrange it to make it sound fresh and new. And then I'll kind of layer stuff on top. If it doesn't start that way, then I've usually found a chord progression or a sample that I've already caught my ear and that I've already been thinking about, like, how do I transform this into something that would fit into the context of what I'm doing. So yeah, it either starts with a beat or some sample or chord progression that I've already kind of like figured out before sitting down. But sometimes it's also like random, right? Like you'll sit down, you'll like smoke a joint or whatever, and you're sitting there and you'll like bang on the keys and you'll hear a sound, or you'll make a sound on a synth.
Happy accident.
Yeah, that like sounds super cool and you're like, oh shit, I can do something with that. So it really depends, but I would say a lot of times it starts with like a beat and then you kind of work from there.
Do you have any habits that you kind of come back to when it comes to music? Like, do you wear the same kind of same pair of sweatpants?
No,
do you always create in the same place?
It's always in the same place. It's always in the same place. And simply out of the fact that like I'm working during the day at like a 9-to-5 job, it does happen to fall within the same times because like I'll go as soon as I'm done working my job, I'll go downstairs in the studio and start like messing around or whatever. But in terms of like rituals or something like that, like I think one of the most important things to do in the creative process is, even if you're not feeling inspired, go sit in the room and go do something. You don't have to create something new, but maybe you chop up some samples. Maybe you make a new drum kit. Maybe you listen to something in the space where you make music by somebody else, so it inspires you. But those kind of things are just like healthy habits to keep up and like constantly be doing something. Like if there's a day where you're not feeling like it, like just go downstairs, like go into your studio and put something on, hit some keys, load up a preset, just play around. And even if you're not feeling, you can always walk away. But like 9 times out of 10, something's going to come out of that just messing around where you're like, oh shit, like I stumbled on something. So just having that momentum of like constantly knowing that even an hour or two working on something musical, even lighthearted or just like administrative, for lack of a better term, where you're just like setting stuff up for next time, I think that's one of like the most like creative things I can do, or like the most habit forming things I do, is just making sure I spend an hour or two every day doing something musical.
Well, that's great advice. So to tag on to that, so let's see, from this album that you performed today, which song would you say you're most proud of?
That's a tough call. A lot of the album was actually just made in the last 2 months. So
love it.
I haven't quite maybe hit a favorite. I think one of the highlights I'll call out, I call it Punjabi folk song because I sampled a Punjabi folk song. My heritage is Punjabi. My parents are Punjabi. So basically I found this track. It was video footage of like 1920s, 1930s India, but it had this folk song in the background. So I like was listening just kind of passively, and I in listening, I heard the loop that I wanted to use. And then 2 seconds later, I heard the string line I wanted to use. So once I got those, and then I added like a beat and a bass line on top of it, I was like, oh shit, this is hot. Like this is gonna be more of a dance floor track versus some of the other stuff is a little bit more like headphone listening or like a little bit more down tempo and chill. I wouldn't really say it's maybe built for other people's dance sets, but maybe I could work into a dance set. But yeah, it's called Punjabi Folk Song. I think it's probably one of the like stronger songs that sounds more like what I was exactly going for with that Indian modern electronic kind of influence. So yeah, that's probably the one I'm most proud of, or at least one that comes to mind.
Awesome. When it comes to actually sitting and creating music, awesome train of thought. That's what I
mean. You can edit this all together, yeah, so it doesn't matter.
So I'm gonna edit out.
So you can pick up.
So the question I was gonna ask. Oh yeah, this one. So next question: what would you say is the main characteristics of a really alive piece of music, like in your opinion?
Yeah, it's a good question. For this album, maybe I'll put it in that context.
Yes,
that sounds great. I focused on a couple of things. I focused on chord progressions that struck some sort of emotion with me, because I knew if I felt something against that chord progression, that other people would too. So that was kind of one of the biggest things.
Would you say you pick an emotion like on purpose, or are you just trying to move people emotionally with the music?
I think it's the latter. It's more just trying to move people emotionally or make an emotional connection with the music. And that a lot of that stems from the fact that I've been producing music for a long time, and none of the music I made leading up to this album struck any emotional chord with myself, except for the fact that I made it. And once I started making this album, and I made a remix last year around this time and put it out, and that was the first like foray into being like, holy shit, I can make this super emotional music without it being sad, but also like evoke some sort of emotional response from people. So yeah, I mean, that was kind of like one of the biggest focuses, was like, how do I connect emotionally with people? Because I know the songs that I love the most, like I have, even if I don't know what the emotional connection is with it, I have some connection with it. And even if you can't put your finger on it, you know it's there. And I wanted that same feeling throughout these songs. It's like, I don't know why I'm like, you know, connected with this, but I feel the connection, or I feel some emotion has been evoked from it.
Well, that's really important. And I think, you know, as a list, obviously we're all listeners here. We're all listen to music. I completely agree that you make a great point. It's not necessarily that I'm always even aware of what emotion is being stirred in me, but I notice in myself that it's moving me emotionally. Right. And kind of the way that I listen to music is when I hear a song for the first time, I immediately think at the end, okay, do I ever want to hear that song ever again?
Right.
And to me, like, that's the dividing line, whether the song moves in a positive direction or not.
Right.
Like, I can hear a song that's good, but I'm not really interested in ever hearing it again.
Well, there's so many songs that are like quote unquote good or popular that just have no emotion behind them. And I feel like that's 99% of like pop music, especially, that's out there, is like the person singing it didn't write the fucking song that they're singing. So like, how do you have any emotional connection to something that someone else put in front of you and was like, here, sing this for $1 million or whatever it is. Like, it just doesn't work for me. Mm-hmm. And like, you know, I don't think it works for a lot of people who, especially people with like a higher musical IQ, like that kind of stuff just doesn't float your boat. Like, why would I listen to something that doesn't make me feel something? Unless it's like straightforward, just like a dirty dance track. And like, yeah, but even then it makes you feel like either nostalgia for being at a club, or like the feeling of wanting to be around other people, or like just wanting to be out and party. That's a feeling, right? But like, I don't know, you listen to any shit on the radio, you're not like, what feeling do you have towards it except for like, I wish the song was over?
Well, that's a great point. All right, we're going to go to the hot mic round. Cool. So I'm going to ask you a few quick questions.
Cool.
First one, who's the artist you pull the most inspiration from and why?
So that changes from time over time, right? Yeah. So like everyone, I think most musicians go through like ups and downs of like who they're listening to the most and where they're inspired from. So I think like right now, it's a little tough because I'm kind of like in between this like weird musical phase.
So I guess top two or three.
Yeah, I think the top two or three artists that I like draw from, one is Move D, who's like a DJ out of Germany. He has been around for a long, long time. He straddled this line between like house music and kind of like low tempo, down tempo ambient music. And everything he does is just like very much out there and forward thinking. So like, whether it's like a lot of the live stuff he does or even his DJ sets, like I'm always just like, fuck dude, like how are you so good at every, like all of this stuff. Another producer that I've just been like loving so much is Paul Wolford. He's also known as Special Request.
I haven't heard either of
these
guys.
Dude, he's fucking incredible. You gotta check him out. He kind of does two works. Paul Wolford is like more piano house, where he'll like have kind of definitely more like tunes you might have heard on like Sirius BPM or one of those things. But then his Special Request moniker is like some of those like dirty breakbeats that I have, where they're like super glitched out, and like he'll have like almost drum and bass or jungle style rhythms, but like put it in like a dance floor context. So I've kind of looked a lot at what he's done and how he's like kind of produced some of that stuff to kind of figure out like, how do I process my beats a little bit more to be as powerful and as like booming as some of the stuff he does.
Well, I think you absolutely nailed it. I mean,
thanks.
The viewers watching your performance today won't be able to tell how much I was feeling it behind the camera. I mean, there was a bunch of drops where I had to let out
I heard you.
Yeah. I had to say something. It was so good.
Well, thank
I was
you.
Really blown away.
Appreciate that.
What has been the most pivotal moment in your musical career so far?
That's a tough one because I've been playing music for a long time.
First thing comes to mind.
Yeah,
it's got to be one.
I think probably like one of the most proudest is when I got to play an after party in Detroit for this big techno fest called Movement. It's like one of the biggest techno fests in the U.S. And I got asked to play this party out of nowhere, and I was like, holy shit, like I've been coming to this festival for a long time and I didn't expect anyone to ever ask me to like play anything associated with it. And I got to play it like a really well-known bar out there, what, like a big party. It was really cool. It's really cool.
Yeah, so to go from a fan and a viewer to a performer.
Yeah, and like I would have been at the party anyway. And it was just like cool to be asked to play. And that was like really inspiring, really like just made me feel really good about myself.
Very cool.
I don't know if it sounds good on what to say, but whatever.
No, hey, it's real. It's the truth. Looking back, what piece of gear would you not have purchased and why?
That's a good question. So I have a lot of gear. I have like an entire fucking room in it. I'm also a little bit of a pack rat with the gear. Like, I don't sell anything. I literally just keep it. Gear that I wouldn't buy. So I don't want to shit talk any companies, but there's like two or three things that I
would. But hold my beer while
No, I don't really, whatever. They're never going to sponsor me or anything. Any Arturia gear, like don't buy it. Just don't buy it.
It's physical gear.
Physical, like Arturia, like the actual hardware they make is so poorly crafted because they're a software company who made hardware, and like, no offense to them, but like any of the actual synths they make, I bought four things from them and three out of four have broken. Wow. And like, don't work anymore. So I only have one thing that still works from them. So like, good on, like, come on, Arturia, fix it. The other is like any of this Roland crap that came out in the last couple of years. It's all like digital recreations of analog shit. And like, yeah, I used the drum machine, the TR-8, but I had the TD-3, the 303 clone that they had. And like, honestly, I maybe used it twice and I just put it back on the shelf because it just didn't fit into anything.
So on the opposite end of that question, the piece of gear you could not live without. Like, if you had to sell everything and keep one thing.
Roland JX8P.
How come?
It's just, like, versatile. It's pretty reliable. Well, pretty reliable. I had to get it fixed once, but that fixed it. It's pretty reliable. It's got really just, like, a smooth sound to it. And it's, like, highly configurable, so I can kind of make it sound like a lot of different other synths. I also just said that because I feel like it's one of my go-tos for a lot of my sounds. So if I like was desert island and it was the only fucking thing I could have, like, could I make tracks with just that? Yeah. That's probably the one I would go with, is like the Roland JX8P. I got it for $275. Shout out roommate who sold it to me, who like was clearly selling his other roommate's shit just to make rent. but like, shout out to that guy for like quoting me $375 on Craigslist and then charged me $275 when I got there. So
on the software side, favorite plugin, like if you had to pick one plugin that you always go to or you love.
Yeah. So only use one plugin. I only use two. I only use two plugins since at all. Yeah. I only use two.
Oh, I meant since. Any virtual plugin on your DAW.
Use two virtual instruments.
Okay.
And one is the Korg M1 plugin. And that's just because like classic house music sounds. The other is like AAS Lounge Lizard, which is like a really nice electric piano VST. And then if we're talking about like effects and stuff, pretty much on every track, I have an SSP twin tube transient designer saturator and a Fab Filter Pro Q equalizer.
Yep.
And then I'll have an Ableton compressor after that. So that's everything. Every channel I have, every track I have has that chain on it just to liven everything up and compress everything.
Hmm. Very cool. That's good to know. All right. And the very last question. We already hit it. Your proudest moment so far.
Fuck yeah. All right. Yeah. I guess we got it then.
So we're all wrapped up here. Thank you so much for
performing. Yeah. Thanks
today.
For having me.
Amazing set.
Oh, thank you very much.
And, yeah, for everyone who's listening, there will be information in the show notes to find the actual link to the music, to the album. When are you going to release this album officially? You know,
TBD. So the album was just finished like last week.
Okay.
So album doesn't have a name yet. The songs are pretty much all named except for one. It still has the project name on it. I don't know when it's going to come out. My plan is right now to shop it around to a couple of labels, see if anyone's interested in releasing it. And if they're not, then I'll self-release probably later this year. So my first foray into like actually trying to get an album out. So it could take a while. I don't know what the real process is. It seems like, remember when I talked to it, it takes a long time if a real label is going to work with you. So we'll see. I will probably be dropping some tracks here and there just for people to listen to ahead of time. But yeah, hopefully sometime this year, hopefully this summer, but more to come.
Wonderful. Up top.
All right, man. Thank you so much for this. I really appreciate the opportunity. This was a lot of fun.
Record. It's focused to me.
Welcome to the Drone Corner, where the nerds hang out with their controllers.
so much for performing for us today.
Thanks for having me.
Boys, what have you seen today?
Some people.
You see any whales?
There's a couple sharks.
Where's the pool at? Where's the pool at?
We saw a couple trees.
Yaka. Brought to you by the Yaka.
We're hanging at the Yaka.